All right, so we're here to work with Sylvester primarily, and one of Sylvester's issues is, the main issue is, I guess, the barking. And so I asked kind of about the exercise, and actually, he gets some exercise, but probably not as much as we'd like. So what I wanted to see is how needy he is. Hey, buddy. So I'll give him a little bit of attention, and then I'm going to kind of hold my arm like, and yes. How often does he stick his nose underneath there and nudge?
All the time.
Okay, so I'm trying to facilitate it there. He's sniffing at me. But so basically, he nudges you. When he does this, he's basically telling you what to do. Pay attention to me, pet me. When he does this, I'm guessing you pet him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when you pet him, when he demands it, then you're basically validating you get to tell the humans what to do, and the humans will do it. So for a lot of dogs, this generates a perception of authority. So the dog starts to think that I have the same authority as my humans. What rules do the dogs have?
As far as?
Things that they would like to do that they're not allowed to do without permission. I see that you have a blanket on the couch. I'm guessing they're allowed in the furniture.
They are, but if we are having dinner or if we're spending time...
So you can ask them to get down.
Yes.
We tell them to go to bed and he'll go to bed.
Okay. But... if we haven't come up with any, so I'm guessing we probably don't have a lot of rules for the dogs.
No, I mean, they don't eat human food, and they can't, if we're at the table or even if we're here, they can't be here. They need to be laying down. They don't get human food. They don't get anything other than a
bowl. Not feeding them human food is really more of a choice for you guys. So, like, a rule would be you're not allowed to be within 10 feet of a human who's eating, or you have to sit before I let you in or out of a door, or things along those lines. Is there any structure in terms of that?
No.
Right.
Okay. So you have kind of, and this is very common with my clients, but you guys kind of have created a bit of the perfect storm. So imagine what kind of employee you would be if you went into work and the boss said, you know what, from now on, I think you're going to be better if you have no rules. So there's no oversight whatsoever. You can do absolutely anything you want, and nobody's going to look at you twice. And I'm in California, I have a medical marijuana license, so I smoke a lot of herb, and I can't remember when I'll pay you, so I won't remember if I paid you 2 minutes ago. So you have to tell me when it's time to pay you. Under those circumstances, you're probably not going to be a very good staffer because you have no motivation to do the work that you're doing there. You might be checking out wedding pictures or doing what you want to do. Typically, rules and boundaries help us kind of govern our behavior. There might be things that we want to do that we don't do. You know, you're in a store and you're like, oh, that's a nice jacket. You don't steal it because there's rules for that and consequences for that. Dogs go through life probing, waiting to be corrected or rewarded. So if that's actually how they test and find out where a boundary is. So for us, we look at it as we're pushing boundaries, as we're kind of pushing limits. They're trying to identify. Half of human canine interaction is us communicating what boundaries and limits and rules are. So if you don't have any rules, the dog thinks, well, if I don't have no rules, I must be the rule maker. If I'm the rule maker, I'm an authority figure. If I'm an authority figure, then I have some status with the humans. And then if I get to tell the humans what to do and they comply, well, then they're validating that I am an authority figure. Now, if I'm an authority figure, then we're peers. Now, you guys are married recently. But if he's wearing a shirt you don't like, you can't tell him, go change that shirt, that makes you look stupid.
Right.
You can tell him that, and you can offer him consequences, but he is going to decide if he changes his shirt because you're peers. So listening to each other is optional. If you have a child, you can tell your child, clear the table. If the child doesn't, then you can, you know, you have the authority to make sure that that happens. So if your dogs see you guys as equals, then they're basically going to do what they want to do as opposed to doing what you want to do. And so when you leave, and he kind of, it sounds like he has some separation anxiety if he barks at people and anytime he's left alone. So basically, when you guys leave, he's a little insecure, and so he kind of freaks out, or he's disagreeing with being left alone. And he's like calling out to you guys, hey, come back, or he sees somebody passing by, he's like, I didn't give you permission to walk in front of my place. So a lack of rules and structure can really give the dogs the impression that they have the same authority as us, and just like us, with responsibility comes stress. And so it's not really natural for a dog to be in charge of humans. So a lot of dogs get overwhelmed, and just like us, they're not gonna give us their best when they're stressed out. So if the dogs, so what I'd like to do is basically help you guys start to flip the leader-follower dynamic. So I want the dogs to identify as being in a follower position to you, just like a child to a parent. So one of the rules I suggest is usually no furniture for 30 days, and then after 30 days, furniture with an invitation per incident, and only for good behavior. So if Sylvester's up on the couch and he sees, or up here, he sees somebody starts barking at him, now he has to immediately get down. And he's sitting up here with me, and then he gets down to go get a drink of water, and he comes back, he needs another invitation to get back up. Now, I usually ask for 30 days because 30 days is we want to make sure the dog really gets into a habit of doing it and just isn't, you know, the first couple days, he's going to really push to try to get back up there. After 2 or 3 days, and the rest of the dogs too, after 2 or 3 days, they figure out that, no, there's something different. Another rule I have is I make a dog sit before I let them in or out of a door. So if I go to the door and tell Sylvester to sit, and I tell all the dogs to sit, and your two Shih Tzus sit, and he doesn't, I'm going to let your Shih Tzus out immediately and close the door. I'm going to walk away and sit down. I don't want to wait there. If I'm waiting there, I'm waiting on him, and he knows it. So I'm going to go sit down, pull out my phone, pull out a newspaper, spend a minute doing something else, then go back to the door and give him another one opportunity, only one opportunity. If he doesn't that time, then I walk away from the door for 2 minutes, then for 4 minutes, then for 8 minutes. So each time he fails to comply on the first time, he has to wait twice as long before he gets another opportunity. Another rule would be, like I mentioned earlier, not being allowed within 10 feet of anyone who's eating food. For dogs, that's very disrespectful. Even if they're not begging, just the proximity is inappropriate. That's how dogs try to take things from other dogs. They invade their personal space. So when you guys are eating, that would be verboten. Showing respect for personal space. You know, a lot of us don't think anything about having a dog sitting right here and leaning on us. We love them and we're not, you know, it's not a blue thing. But if anyone else were to come and sit right here that's not, you know, your partner, that would be inappropriate. So there's nothing wrong with Sylvester coming here when you invite him up here. But he should show a little bit of respect for maybe a 1.5 foot to 3 foot personal bubble of space. And if you invite him in, that's your invitation, not his choice. So we want to take the leadership, the decision-making capabilities away from the dogs so they can identify as being a follower. That way, when you say no, I will listen to you, as opposed to right now where you say no and they probably listen to you when they feel like listening. Is that pretty accurate?
Yes.
Okay. So adding these rules and structure is not going to change everything for you, but it's going to really help the dog start to see and identify you guys as authority figures and will take a lot of stress off of their plate, which a lot of that, just removal of stress, removes a lot of unwanted behaviors. Now we're going to talk about some other things to create some positive reinforcement for the desired behaviors in a separate video. But in this one, let's just kind of focus on rules and structure. So adding rules and structure is going to help all of the dogs feel better about themselves and their relationship to you guys. We're good.
Cool.
You done?
Oh, this?